Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Coaching and Mentoring for Dummies, Second Edition, by Leo MacLeod and Marty Brounstein, narrated by Christopher Grove. Publisher's note: in this audio edition, you will hear references to figures and tables present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Limit of liability / disclaimer of warranty. While the publisher and authors have used their best efforts in preparing this work, they make no representations or warranties with respect to the accuracy or completeness of the contents of this work, and specifically disclaim all warranties, including without limitation, any implied warranties of merchantability or fitness for a particular purpose. No warranty may be created or extended by sales representatives, written sales materials, or promotional statements for this work. The fact that an organization, website, or product is referred to in this work as a citation and/or potential source of further information does not mean that the publisher and authors endorse the information or services the organization, website, or product may provide, or recommendations it may make. This work is sold with the understanding that the publisher is not engaged in rendering professional services. The advice and strategies contained herein may not be suitable for your situation. You should consult with a specialist where appropriate. Further, readers should be aware that websites listed in this work may have changed or disappeared between when this work was written and when it is read. Neither the publisher nor authors shall be liable for any loss of profit or any other commercial damages, including, but not limited to, special, incidental, consequential, or other damages. Introduction. Welcome to the newest edition of Coaching and Mentoring for Dummies. This book can help you grow from a doer manager to a coach and mentor who motivates employees to find purpose in their work and grow as independent problem solvers without micromanaging them. A lot has happened in the world and in the workplace since the first edition of this book was published more than 20 years ago. Organizations are struggling to find and keep good people. Workers are exercising their options to pursue new career opportunities, switch jobs, start their own businesses, and retire altogether from working. The rules have changed in which employers compete for talent and employees hold more of the power. With the increasing labor shortage, no organization can afford to lose people, especially good people. Coaching and mentoring employees to support them in work-life balance, fitting in with the culture, and doing their best work has never been more important than it is today. This book not only helps you understand what it means to be a coach and mentor, it also helps you to adapt and meet the challenges of the changing workplace by altering your role and having a lasting impact in people's lives. Invest in changing yourself and you'll grow as a leader and person. About this book. Over my, Leo, 20 years of coaching, training, and consulting managers, I've heard clients often joke, "My job would be easy if I didn't have to manage people." People performance issues are complicated and often messy. My clients came to me because they've actively avoided dealing with their staff, or else they're too hard and demanding of them. Neither is a good recipe for keeping and retaining people. This book helps you unlock a different way to work and guide people you supervise. You can find out how to gain or improve the coaching skills that drive employee performance and commitment in diverse workforces. Encourage colleagues to deliver results and guide employees to think for themselves. Motivate teams both in person and virtually. Navigate intergenerational issues. Be a sounding board for others and get the best out of your teams. Foster mentoring relationships that help employees grow and stay engaged in their careers. The fundamentals of coaching and mentoring haven't changed. Respect people, take the time to get to know them, ask questions rather than tell, be clear, and take a genuine interest in their growth and success. Here's what's new to this edition. Rapid changes in technology and society mean today's managers need to accept that nothing stays the same, and learn to adapt to continual changes in the workplace. The traditional office environment is increasingly becoming more digital, as more work is done anywhere that has Wi-Fi. Managing teams remotely and creating a cohesive culture continues to present challenges. Recruiting and retaining talent continues to be a top priority for organizations. This edition dedicates an entire chapter on emotional intelligence, EQ, which has emerged as a critical skill for leading diverse teams and creating an attractive company culture in which people can do their best work. EQ can help you understand the role of emotions, behaviors, and attitudes in working effectively with people. Changing demographics and social and political initiatives have made diversity, equity, and inclusion, DEI, a front burner issue for many companies. You'll gain clarity on common DEI terms and find a practical, grounded way to coach and mentor every employee so they feel like they can be themselves and contribute fully. Employees aren't as motivated to help the organization be successful as they are in how the organization can help them achieve their personal and professional goals. Through coaching and mentoring, you'll find ways to give more meaning and balance to employees. Mentorship has evolved beyond the traditional pairing of senior leader with junior staff. Learning from other people takes many forms. A new chapter explores the importance of encouraging employees to develop a diverse support team to help develop in their careers and life. You have the opportunity to play a much larger role in your organization by helping others by following the principles and strategies in this book. You'll discover that when employees are given the opportunity and supported to do their best work, everyone wins. The journey in becoming a successful coach and mentor starts here. Foolish assumptions. When revising this edition, I, Leo, make the following assumptions. You have a basic understanding of what the job of being a manager entails. You have the responsibilities for business functions and for the performance of people, not just yourself. Managing and evaluating staff performance is a major part of your job, or you're someone who aspires to take on such responsibilities in your career one day. Your manager told you you need to coach employees, though you're not sure what that means, or your employees keep asking how they wish they had managers who would mentor them, and you don't want to give them an excuse to go to another company. Icons used in this book. Throughout this book, you may notice the following icons verbalized to grab your attention. Here are the ones in this book. Tip. This icon symbolizes practical tips, ideas, and strategies to make your coaching efforts work. Example. The example icon signals a real or made-up story that illustrates a point being discussed or highlights a manager's experience with a coaching effort. Remember, this icon is a reminder of good ideas or points of information to use when you put coaching into practice. Warning, this icon points out areas to watch out for and avoid. Beyond this book. There's more than enough to keep you busy with the strategies, tips, templates, and checklists in this book. However, you can find more helpful information online. Cheat sheet. Go to dummies.com and type Coaching and Mentoring for Dummies Cheat Sheet in the search box to access information you can refer to again and again. My website, leomacleod.com, leomacleod.com. You can access free resources and tools for help with managing priorities, delegating, mentoring, and having hard conversations. You can also learn about my online courses, which feature short videos and exercises. My book, From the Ground Up, Stories and Lessons from Architects and Engineers Who Learned to Be Leaders, Piehouse Publishing, is useful to any leader who struggles with transitioning from doer to leader and still wants work-life balance. If you have any questions or feedback on the book, or want more information on coaching, training, or speaking, contact me directly at leo@leomacleod.com. Where to go from here? This book isn't linear, so you can glance at the table of contents and jump into any chapter that interests you. To get a good foundation, start with Chapter 2, which illustrates the difference between a doer manager and a coach manager. Chapter 4 lays out the fundamentals of what it takes to build commitment in employees. Chapter 5 dives into how to build your emotional intelligence skills, which I can't stress the importance of enough in coaching and mentoring. Like any book, the information sits unused until it's put into practice. My suggestion is to carve out specific blocks of time, 15 to 30 minutes, to focus on a chapter. Take notes, use a highlighter, or use sticky notes. Try to apply the strategies in the book, and journal, if you like journaling, about your observations and progress. I also encourage you to find colleagues to discuss what you've learned, the challenges you both face, and what's worked and what hasn't. Buy copies of this book for your management team and host a book discussion group. Lastly, tons of other Dummies books go into greater depth into areas I touch on in the book. I can recommend two, including Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion for Dummies by Dr. Shirley Davis and Managing Millennials for Dummies by Hannah L. Ubel, Lisa X. Walden, and Deborah Arbett, both by John Wally & Sons, Incorporated. Part 1. Getting Started with Coaching and Mentoring. In this part, explain what coaching in the business world is, particularly how coaching can help you improve the performance of your team, keeping them engaged and motivated, and giving you some time in your schedule. Distinguish between a doer manager and a coach manager in your role with employees, how you interact, and how you spend your time. Help you value your time differently and provide specific time management strategies to give you time to build commitments and boost performance by staying connected with your staff. Lay a foundation for building trust, engagement, and commitment from your employees by understanding how to set the right tone and introducing a model for building commitment. Leverage the power of knowing yourself and others by developing your emotional intelligence, EQ. Understanding how to build strong collaborative relationships that help you grow as a manager and also helps your employee grow. Chapter 1. Understanding Coaching and Mentoring. Just the Basics. In this chapter, defining what coaching means in the business world, previewing the tools of coaching, comparing coaching versus mentoring. You're a manager, possibly a first-level supervisor, middle manager, or executive. Whether you came upon the role recently or have many years of experience, you know that the job of being a manager isn't getting any easier. You carry a great deal of responsibility, and with the pace of change these days, more may be coming your way before you know it. At the same time, you're expected to lead your group or groups and make them productive. And while you're at it, you have to keep your employees motivated and committed. You can't afford turnover problems. Trying to do it all yourself isn't working as well as you would like it. Maybe your manager has strongly suggested that you change your approach. Stop telling people what to do. Start coaching them. You've heard that coaching is a better way to lead people, but you're not sure what that means or where to start. This chapter lays the conceptual foundation for the book. It introduces what coaching in the business world is all about and delves into its benefits, particularly how coaching can help you improve the performance of your team, keep them engaged and motivated, and give you some time in your schedule for important things that seem to fall by the wayside, like lunch. Getting the lowdown on business coaching. The business of coaching has grown dramatically in the past 20 years. These days, it seems everyone wants to be a coach, but what kind of coach? There are life coaches, relationship coaches, career coaches, and spiritual coaches. All coaching, however, shares a basic orientation to guide people and support people to find their own path. Coaching, as defined in this book, has two aspects to it. It's an approach to how someone functions in the role of being a manager. In the approach of managing as a coach, the manager operates as the leader, developer, and guide of the team and its individuals. It's a set of management skills aimed at getting the most productivity out of an employee performance. These skills or tools require hard work and often a change in old habits. But they work. Together, these two aspects of coaching give managers the best tools to deliver results and positively influence employee commitment. Being a coach means that you see and approach the role of manager as a leader, one who challenges and develops your employees' skills and abilities to achieve the best performance results. In other words, if you manage as a coach, your staff members learn, grow, and work hard too. Coaching is the pathway for multiplying your effectiveness through others, for getting the best out of people's performance. Managers who have discovered how to do this not only have stronger, more functional teams, but they also sleep better and have more time for more important things in their lives. The work of developing as an effective coach and mentor starts by understanding how most managers approach managing people and what kind of changes need to happen to make the transition. See Chapter 2 for more on the skills needed for coaching and mentoring. My path to executive coaching. I, Leo, started my career in marketing and advertising. When I was laid off, I fell into consulting, mostly writing, PR, and client surveys. Clients started to see that I had the ability to relate to their employees and make them feel comfortable discussing their problems. This led to beginning to coach people, though I wasn't sure what that meant. I learned from experience, reading, and taking courses to build my skills. Everything I know, however, is from directly helping people with problems, delegating, having hard conversations, managing their crushing workload, motivating teams, listening, learning to communicate clearly and persuasively, and focusing on the best use of their time. I developed courses with templates and checklists to give people these tools to use. Along the way, I've seen and learned from managers who didn't lead people effectively and others who had figured it out. I made mistakes and learned what sticks and what doesn't, and what changes behavior, and what you need to be successful as a coach. I've taken my years of hard-earned experience of coaching specific skills and put them into this book. What you have is the effective tools and strategies I've used in my successful business that you, as a manager, can use in managing teams. The following sections gives you an orientation to all the ways coaching can help you engage and motivate employees. Sneaking a quick look at the tools of coaching. Understanding and putting coaching tools into practice is a critical step in becoming a coach. Here's a quick look at various coaching tools, all of which I cover throughout this book. Setting goals and performance plans. See Chapter 15. Giving constructive performance feedback. See Chapter 14. Conducting periodic performance reviews. See Chapter 16. Guiding development through mentoring and tutoring. See Chapter 18. Coaching with questions. See Chapter 11. Taking employees under your wing. Motivating employee performance. Delegating to empower and increase productivity. See Chapter 13. Training for skill development. Stimulating and supporting career development. See Chapter 17. Intervening to build improvement in performance. The focus of these 11 coaching skills is on performance, which is the emphasis of coaching, getting the best out of people's performance and helping people grow in their careers. Coaching applies to any personality type, and although it does involve building working relationships, the nature of those relationships varies by individual. Some employees need pushing and firmness. Others need little direction and a light touch. Sometimes you need to give direction and other times support. That is, the use of the coaching skills or tools is tailored to fit individual skill levels and needs. You carry out these coaching skills through conversation and collaboration. These skills involve working with an employee in order for that person to go back to their job and perform successfully. Dedicating focused time to coach people is the key. Refer to Chapter 3. Getting on board with coaching. Do any one of the following challenges and pressures affect you in your job as a manager? Do more with fewer resources. Get employees to adapt to change. Find ways to increase efficiency and productivity. Create an environment to retain employees. Meet greater customer expectations. Deliver results. Thought so. In today's increasingly fast-paced, ever-changing, and highly competitive environment, demands such as these are affecting many organizations, especially their managers. Demands and pressures cut across all types of businesses, private and public sectors, for-profit and non-profit enterprises, and across all levels of management, from the top executive to a newly promoted first-level manager. Yet what hasn't always kept pace with all these changes and expectations is the way that managers manage. Far too many managers still operate a task-focused or a must-maintain-control fashion. If I just do more hands on myself and tell everybody to do more, and everyone will get along just fine, right? Or I can toss in a few buzzwords or phrases to help. All right, everyone, you've been empowered. Now work smarter, not harder. The problem is, managing this way just doesn't work. Tip: because today's challenges aren't going away, managing as a coach is a necessity not only for your success, but also for your survival. Coaching is about helping others become more effective, developing employees to perform to their best ability and to function as self-sufficiently as possible, and challenging employees to take on responsibility instead of waiting to be told what to do. It also means supporting and involving your employees in the process. Remember, coaching influences employee adaptability, productivity, and retention. It helps you make better use of your time. But many new and different efforts are needed. The road to success starts by making the shift from managing as a doer to managing as a coach. Read Chapter 2 to understand the difference. Differentiating between coaching and mentoring. In the business world, the terms coaching and mentoring are often used synonymously. Here's how this book distinguishes the two. Coaching. Coaching is a set of skills to interact and empower employees to be more self-sufficient problem solvers. Unlike other forms of coaching, the focus here is on job performance, what's needed and expected in this position. A coaching approach can be used in mentoring employees by asking questions and engaging them, but the primary focus here is helping them do their job. Mentoring. Mentoring is more focused on supporting the employee in their own development as a professional. It's often driven by the employee's needs rather than the demands of the job. It can include learning from a more senior person to fill in gaps in knowledge. But mentoring often goes beyond teaching someone by taking them under your wing. Mentors often advise and support people on their career and life. The focus isn't just on performance, but on the needs of the employee. Coaching and mentoring often work together, and the lines aren't always clear. Here are some examples to help you see how the roles play out. Example: Judith was a new hire at a marketing agency. Her role was to support the client managers with administration of social media campaigns. Judith's experience was limited to doing some case studies in college. She didn't understand what to do. Her manager, Samantha, sat down with her to explain what was expected and how to be successful at the agency. She asked Judith questions to understand her experience and career goals. Samantha could see that Judith was feeling overwhelmed. She suggested that for the first week that Judith just observe more experienced people doing their tasks. She bonded with Jack, who was also fairly new. Jack and Judith went out to lunch, and Jack played an important role in helping her feel comfortable. Samantha played more of a coaching role in guiding and engaging Judith. Her meetings were intentional. They were goal-oriented toward getting her up to speed. She used a lot of questions to learn about Judith and took time to spell out the expectations. Samantha also suggested a course of action that would help Judith learn gradually. Jack, on the other hand, played more of a mentor for Judith. He taught her his approach by letting her observe. He waited for her to ask questions. It was relaxed and friendly and gave Judith someone she could start to confide in. The relationship was more balanced. Jack was there for her, but he didn't have an agenda other than to help her with whatever she needed. As this example illustrates, coaching and mentoring are both valuable tools. Unlike any tool, it all depends on the specific need. A wrench and pliers are similar, but one is better to certain applications. Flip to Chapter 2 to look more closely at the role and approach that coaches take. For more information on mentoring, check out Chapters 18 and 19. Coaching and mentoring share the same end goal, to help and support the employee's growth. Chapter 2. Switching from Doer to Coach. In this chapter, contrasting doers versus coaches, making the change to managing as a coach, appreciating your changing role. This chapter explains why the switch from doer to leader is important but often difficult. It helps you distinguish between a doer and a coach in everyday practice and how you can begin to make the switch. You may want to return to this chapter to see how you're doing in making the transition. Pace yourself. It's natural and too easy to slip back into the doer role. Managing as a coach versus as a doer. Coaching is an approach to management, how you function in the position of a manager. Although different leadership or management styles exist, how managers approach their roles tends to be one of two ways, as a coach or as a doer. The following are descriptions of how the two approaches generally function. Coach approach. Managers work to achieve the best operational performance results by developing and maximizing the talents and abilities of employees to their fullest. Those who manage as a coach still perform tasks. In fact, many work alongside their staffs doing some of the same duties. Yet those who approach management as a coach recognize they also need to lead and develop others to top performance, because that is how the tasks best get done. Such managers live by the principle of and. That is, they approach their jobs as a balance of managing both task issues and people issues. They see the two as connected. They see managing people as part of managing the work the people do. Doer approach. In this approach, managers tend to focus more on task issues of the job and also the technical issues of their work, as well as on the group's performance. Their attention tends to go first to the things they themselves have to do and to the areas of greatest comfort, task and technical issues. Doers, as a result, tend to function as senior individual contributors. While the style of doers varies from controlling to very hands-off to a combination of the two, the doer approach to management tends to live by the principle of or. They have task issues to handle or people issues to handle. These issues are often viewed as separate sides of the manager's role rather than interrelated ones. So doers tend to put much less emphasis on how people are performing, which is usually less comfortable to deal with, than on getting things done. Remember, a common feature of both management approaches is that managers have their own tasks to perform. Few ever focus solely on managing others. The key difference in the two approaches, however, is on where a manager focuses their attention. Table 2-1 gives you a quick preview of the tendencies the coach and doer managers exhibit when handling six of the most common management functions. To help you see this difference in greater detail, the following sections illustrate how managers using the two approaches would handle various functions. As you check out the general tendencies of each approach, keep in mind that general tendencies mean just that. Things don't work exactly the same way all the time. Table 2-1. Coaches versus doers. Approaches to management functions. Management function. Planning. Coach. Invests time in doing it. Often involves others in shaping plans. Is future-focused. Doer. Has little time for planning ahead. Tends to operate on a day-to-day or short-term basis. Often crisis-driven and firefighting. Management function. Goal setting. Coach. Works with others to develop goals and plans to achieve them. Ensures that goals are written and expectations are clear, and then manages by them. Doer. If operates with goals, tends to give staff their goals. Little employee involvement. often tends to be activity and task-oriented as opposed to results and goal-driven. Management function. Giving performance feedback. Coach. Does so on an ongoing basis. Feedback is tied to what employees are doing. Provides both positive and negative feedback so staff knows where they stand. Doer. Seldom, unless something goes wrong or gives occasional, vague praise. May do so at annual review time. Management function. Dealing with performance issues. Coach. Addresses issues in a timely way with solutions-oriented approach. Works with employees to map out plans for improvement. Coach. Many avoid dealing with these issues. Is outside of comfort zone. May seek punitive measures as the first action to deal with problems. Management function. Delegating. Coach. Does as much as possible to maximize resources and increase productivity. Provides necessary support, lets people handle the job, and holds them accountable. Doer. Finds letting go of responsibility to others hard to do, and thus delegates little beyond simple tasks. If willing to delegate, dumps assignments, gives little guidance and support. Management function. Mentoring and developing staff. Coach. Takes an active interest and involvement in employee learning and growth. Supports training and encourages opportunities to expand employee capabilities. Doer. Tends not to put much attention in this area. Takes a learn-on-your-own approach to employee development. Planning. Planning is a critical management function that entails looking to the future and setting a course of action to get there. Here's how the coach and doer deal differently with planning. Coach approach to planning. The manager as coach takes time to plan. After all, you don't get ahead unless you plan ahead. The coach realizes this and doesn't just focus on what's happening now, but constantly looks to the future and often involves others in shaping plans to reach future goals. This future focus is often part of the conversation that a coaching manager has with their staff. Doer approaching to planning. The doer manager tends not to spend much time planning, too much to deal with now to worry about that later on stuff. Doers tend to have a day-to-day focus, reacting to the problems at hand and incurring frequent interruptions. In other words, their days are often full of other people interrupting them with one problem after another. Crisis management and firefighting is the norm. "I don't have the time to plan," is a common complaint of doer managers. The coach manager can sometimes fall into this reactive mode. However, when a coaching manager senses that people are getting caught too much into firefighting, they'll coach them on fire prevention. Goal setting. Goal setting is defining what needs to be accomplished in performance to achieve desired results. Here's how the two approaches differ. Coach approach to goal setting. The coach manager often involves group members in shaping the group's goals, and most definitely works with individual team members so that they know what their individual goals are. When you work for someone who manages as a coach, you know what your priorities are and what's expected of you. In fact, goals and plans are usually written so that no one has to rely on memory. Doer approach to goal setting. If goals exist, the doer approach tends to give people their goals. Less time is spent discussing and working together to shape goals and plans. In many cases, no set or articulated goals exist. Doer managers tend to be more task-oriented than goal-focused. They know what needs to get done now and maybe in the near future. But goals are the bigger picture stuff, a series of tasks that together accomplish an end result. Goals are about achieving significant results. The major improvements to be made and the targets to be hit aren't often on the doer's radar screen, or if goals exist, they're rarely part of conversations between managers and employees. As a result, the doer manager's staff tends to be absorbed with activities and being busy, or at least looking that way, instead of being focused on important results to achieve. Giving performance feedback. Performance feedback is letting others know what you've observed in their efforts and performance. It's acknowledging what people have done and how they've performed. Coach managers and doer managers sharply differ on how they regard performance feedback. Coach approach to giving performance feedback. The coaching manager provides ongoing, timely feedback to their employees so they know where they stand in terms of their performance. When something is done well, coaches provide performance feedback. When something needs to be done better, coaches provide performance feedback. The coach works to give the feedback, both positive and negative, with specifics and timelines, as near as possible to the time the performance occurred. The coach provides feedback about both the individual's work and behaviors. Whatever issues of performance are involved, when something is worth acknowledging, the coach avoids sitting back and saying nothing. These managers verbalize their observations. Coaches understand that providing performance feedback as a regular practice reinforces behaviors that align with company values and create a culture where employees can do their best work. For more on giving constructive feedback, see Chapter 14. Example. Here is what it might sound like to give positive feedback. Bob, I really like how flexible you are when working with challenging customers. You have a great way of de-escalating emotions and working towards sound solutions. Thank you. Similarly, managers know how to criticize but often don't know how to give specific reinforcing performance feedback either. For instance, Susan, I've noticed you've been spending time each month sharing your expertise with junior staff. Your modeling of how to collaborate and develop the skills of others is impressive, and I appreciate your initiative to do so. Doer approach to giving performance feedback. The doer manager tends to give feedback less frequently and with less specifics. Employees tend to hear from them only when something goes wrong or during their annual review time. Otherwise, no news usually means good news, or so employees hope. Little recognition takes place, and areas for improvement are often glossed over. Similarly, providing vague and useless positive feedback like "good job" or "keep up the good work" isn't useful. Vague performance feedback like "you need to do a better job collaborating with others" or "I need you to be at work on time." What do better and on time mean? Employees working for a doer often aren't sure where they stand in their performance, or some may think their performance is better than it really is. In the latter case, no news means distorted views. When doer managers spend all their time focused on work, they miss the opportunity to provide feedback that can reinforce company values. As a consequence, people don't understand how they're doing unless it's during a formal review process. But the opportunity to consistently build culture from regularly providing performance feedback is lost. Dealing with performance issues. Sometimes employees aren't performing to the level you need. Such situations are one of the biggest challenges for managers. Coaches and doers have fundamentally different ways of handling performance issues. Coach approach to dealing with performance issues. When someone isn't performing as well as needed, the coach approach is to work with the person first. The emphasis is on coaching to improve, clarifying expectations, developing plans of action that target improvement, and providing support to help make improvement happen. The coach doesn't wait for performance issues to turn into big problems either. They respond with early intervention, using a positive, solutions-oriented, firm touch. Doer approach to dealing with performance issues. The doer manager quite often follows the management by osmosis path in dealing with performance problems, avoiding them and hoping for the best. The idea is that employees will read your mind and figure out that better performance is needed. You don't have to be an experienced manager to figure out what happens when performance issues aren't dealt with. They get worse. But for many doers, dealing with a performance issue is as far from the comfort zone as you can go, so they practice big-time avoidance. For some doers, often after avoiding the problem for a while, the mode of operation is to get tough, if not downright punitive, threatening the employee with their employment, putting the poor performer on written warning, or outright firing them. These punitive-type efforts, especially when done without two-way communication and an attempt to coach the employee, can ripple through the company. People may wonder if they're next. Motivation and engagement suffers when employees are consumed with fear and anxiety about their positions and how they're doing. Throw a group of doer managers a technical problem, and what do? They go into problem-solving mode. Throw them a personnel-related problem, and they either run from it or want to eliminate it as soon as possible. Delegating is entrusting others with assignments and responsibility. The coach and doer contrast greatly in how they handle this function. Here's a more detailed explanation. Coach approaching to delegating. The coach delegates as much as possible for one simple reason. You can't do everything yourself. The coach looks to maximize the resources at hand and increase productivity. The coach delegates meaningful responsibilities and projects, not just busy work, and provides the necessary support, resources, and accountability that employees need to do their jobs well. They understand that people will fail as they grow, just as they themselves did. They're patient and understanding and mentor employees as they develop the skills and confidence. Effective coaches rely on delegation to free themselves to focus on important matters that are often ignored or left alone, such as planning, networking, professional development, and mentoring. Doer approach to delegating. Take a guess at the doer approach to delegating. For many, a doer manager, delegating meaningful responsibilities and assignments to staff isn't a frequent practice. How come? For many, delegating beyond assigning simple tasks feels like a loss of control. In addition, the doer lives by the adage that if you want to get a job done right, you do it yourself. Doers who do believe they're delegating are more often dumping tasks without taking the time to coach and support the employees. Here, you do it, because I don't want to, and don't screw the job up or bother me with it. Not surprisingly, such assignments often end up making the employee look bad and reinforces the doer's belief that they're the only ones who can really do good work. Some leaders may be perfectionists who feel it's easier to do everything themselves or believe that their work is better than others. Sometimes referred to as a self-enhancement bias, the practice of holding on to work and not delegating it is counterproductive to building and growing employees, as well as the productivity of the organization. Mentoring and developing staff. Mentoring and developing involves making the effort and showing interest in helping your staff grow in their skills and capabilities. It involves teaching, encouraging, and challenging them to do their best. As you may suspect, coaches place far more emphasis on employee development than doers. Here are some of the differences. Coach approach to mentoring and developing staff. Such managers thrive on working with their employees and helping them develop their skills and capabilities. They ask questions more than they give answers. They give their staff challenging opportunities, and they share their insights and stories. They regularly take an interest in employees' careers and job situations and encourage training and other learning experiences. Remember, from the coach perspective, the more capable your employees, the more productive and self-sufficient they are. Developing strong people resources is a source of pride, not a source of insecurity. It's also important to the business because it creates the next generation of leaders, computer programmers, surgeons, and so on, and ensures a steady talent pipeline for continuity of business. Doer approach to mentoring and developing staff. Quite often, the doer is too busy to spend time mentoring and stimulating employee development. The comfort to do this is lacking. If employees are particularly observant, they can still learn from the doer because many doers are knowledgeable and skilled in their work. But employees tend not to learn with the doer. And if employees watch carefully, sometimes they may learn what not to do. Beyond good, old-fashioned on-the-job training, OJT, which you learn on your own, any organized or focused efforts on employee development are infrequent occurrences. The lack of development or development opportunities is one of the top reasons people leave their jobs. Decoding the doer culture. Many doer managers are hard workers and high achievers, and are sometimes even technically brilliant. But in terms of effectiveness in a management role and the ability to develop others to deliver high levels of performance, doers tend to fall short in comparison to managers who are coaches. Yet in my, Marty, experience as an employee, a manager, and as a consultant working for a number of years with managers at all levels in a wide variety of organizations, the vast majority of managers tend to function more as doers than as coaches. In fact, when I discuss this point with most managers, from first-level supervisors to top executives, they agree with me and are often insightful at answering the question, how come? The next section explores the reasons why doer managers are more the norm. Identifying why more managers are doers. So why do more managers function as doers? Take a look at the following. Remember, if you see yourself as one of the millions who tend to manage more like a doer than a coach, should you be worried? Yes, if you care about being a leader who brings the best out of people. Who gets promoted? How do people usually get started in management roles? They're promoted from the ranks of the individual contributors. And the ones who earn the promotions are generally good doers. That is, those who are technically competent. Few people who are technically incompetent are made managers. The high-performing salesperson is promoted to sales manager. The top engineer becomes the engineering manager. The hard-working accountant is promoted to accounting supervisor, and so on. The logical career path for good performers is to move into management. But the preparation for the role and the demonstration of leadership abilities required for the role are seldom seen. And after they're promoted from the ranks, organized training and mentoring efforts on how to become an effective manager generally don't occur on a regular basis, beyond the one-day shot at an external or internal seminar. Many doers continue to earn promotions and work their way to higher levels of management because they're high achievers and show technical competence, if not brilliance. If they have strong personalities, they have an added advantage. A track record of coaching and developing others and functioning as a real leader, rather than as a senior individual contributor, aren't usually major prerequisites for advancement. Who are your role models? Because most managers are doers, having been promoted because of their worker bee mentality, most managerial role models are doers. And although you may admire their technical expertise, you may have less admiration for their leadership and coaching skills. Because little training or mentoring is done to guide them in different ways of managing, they follow in the path that's familiar to them. In addition, the recognition and rewards that managers get often has little to do with their abilities to coach and develop others. Certainly, they're rewarded when they're effective coaches. But more often, the recognition and rewards come because managers show that they're strong performers and high achievers in their areas of expertise: sales, finance, engineering, operations, and so on. A vice president or department head, for example, often has years of management experience. But experience tells only how long someone performed, not how well they performed. What do managers work to develop? The final reason for an abundance of doer managers relates to the background and the expertise of most managers. A vast majority of managers have their educational degrees in a field related to their career work: engineering, business, marketing, public administration, finance, and so on, and not in management. Although some managers may have degrees unrelated to their current managerial functions, or no college degree at all, you seldom find that they have a degree or related training in management with an emphasis on coaching. So what they lack in education related to their current position, they make up for in what they have learned through experience in their jobs, right? More often than not, managers tend to focus their own educational development, through seminars, conferences, reading material, and so on their technical fields of expertise. Ongoing concentrated learning efforts in leadership and coaching aren't the norm for many people in management roles. Do a comparison for yourself. How many hours have you devoted to management development versus technical development during the past year or two? Many managers and executives overlook the fact that management is a discipline itself, a field of study. Mastery is never achieved. Being effective requires continuous learning, because managing people and helping them achieve their best performance is no small feat. You don't have to be remarkable to know how to coach. You just have to be open to learning and willing to work hard at it. Doing the work to make the switch. Switching from doer to coach takes time and commitment. Keep these in mind. Doers aren't bad people. They just need to focus on coaching. You're part of a very big club. Coaches are doers too. They carry out tasks, but also focus on leading, developing, and maximizing the resources they have to get the best performance results. Technical competence is important for coaching effectively. You certainly have to understand the functions that people work at in order to help develop them to better perform in these functions. Moving from doer to coach. Embrace the and. Example. Consider this example with a story. Joy, an engineering manager, was given two main responsibilities. Take a production group that now reports to her out of a restructuring situation and build them into a productive team, and lend her technical expertise to a cross-functional engineering project. Joy had been in management a few years, but the job at hand was a new experience. To help her work effectively with this new group, Joy's manager made training and consulting resources available, but it was up to Joy to make use of the resources. What did she do? After some initial efforts to start meetings with the production group, and after facilitating a few hours of team training for them, Joy became engrossed with the responsibilities of the engineering project. Within a short time, 90% of her time went to the project, the rest to the group she was supposed to manage. What happened to the group? Not hard to guess. They floundered. Chaos reigned and morale suffered. The training and cross-training that was available hardly occurred, and plans for building the team were never set. What approach did Joy take? That of classic doer. She got caught in the tunnel vision of or. She approached her job with an all-or-nothing mindset, giving her attention to either one major responsibility or the other. She quickly gravitated to the area of greatest comfort, her technical side. Little coaching and leadership took place. Joy wasn't able to balance her responsibilities and see that both tasks, her new group to manage and her project to complete, were equally important. In her previous position, she had managed a few engineers who worked fairly independently, so her doer tendencies had never gotten in the way. With a new group, however, coaching skills were in great demand, but she responded as a doer. The key, then, is to work at making the shift from doer to coach. You begin the shift by grasping the concept of approaching your management role as a coach. This concept involves understanding that your people and task management responsibilities go hand in hand. They're not separate entities. This is the view of and, balancing task issues and people issues, versus the tunnel vision of or, handling task issues or people issues. Remember, the view of and, balancing task issues and people issues, is critical for making the shift from doer to coach, as the nearby sidebar explains. You as a manager have many priorities, some related to the work activities within the group or groups you manage, and others related to matters that take your time and attention outside your group. These priorities may range from working on your own projects to spending time with your boss to interacting with customers. The view of and says you have to see all of your priorities and coach your employees so that they will function as productively and self-sufficiently as possible. appreciating your new role as a coach and not a doer. When Forbes magazine compiled the top 50 attributes of leadership, the one skill that stands above others is influence. The most effective leaders understand and appreciate their unique role in getting more work done by engaging staff to bring their best thinking and hardest effort to projects, not by single-handedly producing work and billing more hours. Liz Wiseman, in her book Multipliers, identified two types of managers. Multipliers. They use coaching and mentoring to get the most out of employees. Their impact is measured not by what they produce by themselves, but how they can multiply their efforts by generating more work from others. Multipliers have a much greater impact on firms by understanding they don't need to be responsible for the final work product, but instead can tap the collective wisdom and energy of the team. The less they're involved, the more that gets done, and the more people grow into independent problem solvers and leaders. The art of leadership is understanding how to affect what the organization provides to clients and customers with minimal control of how it's done. Diminishers. They control, criticize, alienate, and unempower employees. Their efforts diminish the total output of the team. Managers who come from a doer role often struggle with the switch from doer to coach. They hold on to control too tightly. They stifle creativity and ownership, and they direct and chastise employees for not doing it their way. As a result, they can easily fall into the diminisher camp, often without realizing it. Rather than to judge doer/managers too harshly, the following sections look at why they often struggle with letting go of the doer role. Calculating the cost of letting go. Imagine waking up one day to realize that your entire approach to work had to change for you to advance in your career. That's what it can be like for doers to transition into being team leaders. Why is it hard? These sections identify some challenges to switching from a doer to a coach. Solving problems is natural. Great doers are really good problem solvers. They take pride in analyzing and coming up with a solution that's unique and effective. It's ingrained in how they approach work and what gives them joy and personal satisfaction. As a coach, you have to learn to not problem solve, but coach others to do the solving. It often takes time to appreciate coaching others versus doing it yourself. Letting people down. When your identity is wrapped up in delivering a quality solution that customers come to expect, letting go of your way of doing a project doesn't feel good. As a coach, you're being encouraged to let others take ownership and be accountable for their work. And when that work doesn't meet the standards you've set with clients and yourself, you can feel like you're letting people down. After all, they've come to expect your results, not those of someone who is learning and has their own style and approach. Missing the work. You came into your field, whether it's being a hospital administrator, safety inspector, or real estate salesperson, because you love the work. You've invested time into learning it and mastering it. And now the reward for being on top of your game is to do less of it. After all, missing the work as you transition from doer to coach is only natural. Going back to the beginning. Learning how to be a coach and mentor is a new skill. You'll be challenged and humbled by how many times you get it wrong. Say the wrong thing, do the wrong thing. You'll yearn for the days when you're on top of your game and not a beginner in a new game. Recognizing that what got you here won't get you there. If you want to transition from doer to coach/mentor, reflect on what you may have to give up. Become more aware of the difference between doing versus coaching/mentoring. Simon Sinek, author of many leadership books, says that the role of a leader isn't to come up with all the great ideas. The role of a leader is to create an environment in which great ideas can happen. The challenge before you is letting go of just being a doer and switching to a coach/mentor. On one side is doing it the way you're accustomed to. On the other side is having a greater impact in the company and growing as a leader. Remember, the reality is what got you here won't get you there. The skills and mindset of a doer are different than a coach. To get there, the place where you are respected as a professional, influence others to do their best work. To do so, you need to adopt a new sense of your role beyond being a doer. To be acutely aware of how you're spending your time, what you're focusing on at any one time during the day, and how you're interacting with people. Tip: you're not the first one, and won't be the last one to go through the transition from doer to coach. Find someone you respect and admire who has gone through it. Take them out to lunch and interview them on how they managed the transition. Did they find it difficult to let go? How did they learn to let go? Is it really worth it? You may have found a lifelong mentor who can help you along the way. And what better way to encourage mentorship in your organization than getting one yourself and modeling that it's okay to ask for help? Chapter 3. Finding the time to stay connected. In this chapter, contrasting how coaches and doers view and use their time, identifying strategies for staying connected with your staff, preparing and organizing your coaching meetings, facilitating effective two-way coaching meetings. Coaches recognize the importance of staying connected and involved with employees. Staying connected is what builds the working relationship and the personal influence that affect employee performance. Successful coaches make spending time with employees a priority. Spending time with employees means stopping what you're doing and having a live conversation focused on tasks, challenges, and concerns. Coaching is a collaborative effort and requires a two-way conversation. Listening and asking questions drives coaching conversations. Doer managers tend to be more directive and don't take the time needed for collaboration. Without collaboration, you're just telling someone what to do. When you operate from a position of authority instead of a personal influence, you don't get commitment. You get compliance. This chapter uncovers the blocks that doer managers often face when trying to make the switch to coach. Here I help you shift how you value your time and give you specific time management strategies to give you time to build commitments and boost performance by staying connected with your staff. Using your time, coaches versus doers. As you move up in your organization, time becomes one of your most valued assets. In my, Leo, experience, no manager has enough time to do everything they need to do to be successful and meet commitments for clients, staff, management, not to mention themselves. As a manager, you have to constantly prioritize what's important and make hard decisions of what you aren't going to do. You have to weigh what's the most critical to focus on and what to ignore, delay, or delegate. To make the best decisions on how to manage time and what to prioritize in transitioning from doer to coach, the first step is understanding how doers and coaches each view and use time. Take this opportunity to evaluate how you currently manage your time and if there are ways you can better maximize your impact by coaching and mentoring employees rather than doing work. Time and the doer. Doer managers often find themselves in crisis mode. Because they seldom delegate key decisions or responsibilities, or develop others to the point that they can help tackle day-to-day problems, doers get stuck in a firefighting mode of dealing with one problem after another. Employees can walk into their offices with a problem, the monkey, and walk out of the offices relieved that the monkey is off their backs. Where did it go? To the manager, of course, who takes on all problems and tries to solve them by themselves. Because doer managers often are in crisis mode, their focus tends to be short-term. What's hot for today? Maybe next week. Don't ask them where their groups will be in a year or even in 6 months. Don't ask them what issues they need to be working on in order to meet the future demands of their business. They have too many fires to fight today to worry or even think about the future. Who has the time to do that anyway? Doer managers may appear to be productive, but their focus is too often on projects. They're focused on the immediate, short-range tasks and busy work. Coaching managers, by contrast, take a longer view of how they spend time and understand taking time for people is a better investment for the organization and everyone involved. Doer managers often fall into the three particular groups. Interruption-driven manager. These managers let themselves be interrupted by anything or anyone who wants a response right away. Let me tell you a story to see if it resonates. Example. One day, I, Leo, arrived for a coaching session with a project manager. The receptionist said the project manager was wrapping up a call and would be out soon. From my seat, I could see across the office to where my client was immersed in her call. As she hung up, she glanced at her computer screen and dove into, I assume, responding to an email. And then someone came up to her desk to ask her a question while she was typing. After 15 minutes of observing her, I decided to approach and remind her of our appointment. She literally jumped out of her chair. "Oh my gosh, I forgot about you. I mean, I didn't. I had a meeting in my calendar until a client called, and then I tried to answer somebody's question. I got distracted." Sound familiar? Microsoft conducted a study and found that every interruption costs employees about 50 minutes of productivity, whether they're being interrupted or breaking from a task. Part of that loss is due to the time it takes to recover and refocus on the task. But the study also found that a new distraction, in the form of a new email, text, call, or a person with a question, keeps employees from refocusing on their original task. Employees often spend as much time managing interruptions as they do completing work. The only criteria that interruption-driven managers use is urgency, not importance, by responding immediately to anything and everything that comes their way. Coaching staff almost never falls into an immediate emergency that requires attention. Coaching conversations aren't rushed. They're deliberate, intentional, and thoughtful. Interruption managers are too easily distracted and pulled away from coaching conversations. The multitasking manager. Because time is finite, these managers try to cram as much in as possible by multitasking, thinking and doing many things at the same time. Job descriptions often ask for candidates who can multitask, but according to neuroscience, multitasking is a myth. What is commonly referred to as multitasking is better described as task switching. The brain isn't capable of intently focusing on two serious tasks at the same time. The human brain doesn't perform tasks simultaneously. It performs them in a sequence, one after another. When you're multitasking, you're switching back and forth between the things you're doing. Trying to multitask introduces several problems, such as the following. Working quickly and incompletely in any one area makes it easy to make mistakes. The switching breaks your thought patterns in any one task, often compromising the connection of ideas and momentum of building on ideas. Pulling away from one task, a conversation for instance, to focus on another, a text message, shortchanges both tasks. Someone can easily rush through tasks or conversations and not be totally present. You can easily lose your place when you don't finish one task before doing another. A person can risk with half-done work or have to spend time backtracking to find their place again. Your pile of work gets larger as new tasks go on top of the pile of half-finished tasks. Multitasking all day is exhausting. Minds are muscles that can get overworked by all that switching during the day. Multitasking managers are rarely good coaches because they're too accustomed to splitting their attention on many things instead of focusing on one person and one issue at a time. They aren't particularly good listeners and aren't patient communicators because their minds are on other things they should be doing. Isolated manager. The isolated manager simply doesn't make the time for anything other than work. They see their primary value as doing work, which is quantifiable, important, and can always be rationalized as the most important priority. Businesses like attorneys, consultants, and architects make money by billing their time. A coaching conversation doesn't qualify as billable time that they can charge a client. It's time that's unbillable and unprofitable. As a result, they isolate themselves in doing tasks rather than on coaching or mentoring staff. In addition, they may feel uncomfortable socially interacting or teaching staff. Maybe they don't like it because they're not good at it. It's just too much work and easier to not be available by hiding behind work. Time and the coach. Coaching managers view their time like money. It's an investment to use wisely. They view spending time with people and issues as the way to get a return on their investment. So like money, time isn't to be wasted. For example, if spending time with an employee, perhaps to help them get a better handle on doing an assignment, will yield more self-sufficiency for that employee, a coaching manager invests the time now and receives a payoff later. If, on the other hand, your employees frequently interrupt you with questions, constantly giving them answers isn't the best use of your time. So a coach manager will teach employees how to find their own answers so that they can become more self-sufficient. Tip: the theme here is helping people do a better job themselves. Coaching is about getting the best performance out of people so that they can do for themselves. Because coaches see that people have an effect on the tasks to be done, they know that investing time in people in order to increase their abilities to perform well is an investment well worth making. Your reward for doing so is increased productivity, and you actually save time. Instead of going from one interruption to another, your time and attention can be spent on the critical issues, which is what managers are really being paid to do. Because coaching managers realize that they don't have a quantity of time to give to their employees, they know that the time they spend must be quality time. Quite simply, they make the time count, make it productive time rather than inefficient time. Here are some concrete examples of how coaching managers decide to use time differently than doer managers. Instead of being interrupted 60 times by one employee in the course of a week, a coach spends 1 hour with the employee preparing them to handle the challenges of the daily job. That's quality time. Instead of watching employees become frustrated and stuck over a problem, and instead of falling into the trap of telling them how to solve every problem they encounter so that they can't think for themselves, a coach spends time helping them map out a plan to solve problems. That's quality time. Instead of chasing after an employee 3 times a day to see whether they're completing tasks, the dreaded micromanagers, as employees call them, a coach takes a half hour with that employee once a week to do a status review on the project. That's quality time. Instead of wasting time redoing an employee's sloppy work, losing sleep on whether to replace the employee, and complaining to colleagues for hours, a coach sits down with the same employee to explain the importance of accuracy and engages the employee to solve the problem together. That's quality time. Tip: even though the doer manager is just on the go, a coach manager makes their time count. To make your time count, structure and organize your time by asking the following questions. What's the best use of my time? What are my current commitments before I take on anything new? Does this task require my attention, or should someone else do it? A coaching manager's approach is to make these questions part of the planning process so that they're more intentional and purposeful about how they use time. Recognizing what's important and urgent. There's no shortage of tasks and distractions that fill each day. Urgent tasks demand your immediate attention. Important tasks have greater significance. Many people often get the two things mixed up. There's a common expectation for immediate feedback. When people want to know something, they search online and get the information immediately. They want to know if their partner can pick up eggs from the store, so they quickly text. They even get frustrated if the internet speed is slow and the page takes a few seconds to load, or someone doesn't text them back right away. In many ways, people are addicted to a sense of urgency driven by the speed of technology. They want it now, no matter how unimportant that thing is. They expect immediate responses from everyone. They want answers now. When they don't get a response from an email right away, they send a text. Example. Maria is walking to her desk and sees Floyd getting up from his chair to corner her about work she gave him. Meanwhile, a text comes in from her partner that the gas company needs access to their furnace in the basement. Maria sees a sticky note from her supervisor on the back of her chair to come see her as soon as possible. She does need to talk to Floyd, so he can complete the project on time. After sitting down, she quickly glances at her email inbox and sees 200 unread messages. She starts to read and answer the most recent email, so she can feel like she's getting something done, when she gets another text from her partner, and Floyd shows up at her desk. Maria needs help. She needs a way to first distinguish between tasks that require her immediate attention and those tasks that can wait, and she needs a way to prioritize and focus on the important tasks. Remember, not everything that's urgent is important. Ask yourself these questions throughout the day to help you identify what is really important. What am I currently doing? Is it the best use of my time? Am I just reacting, or is this email, text, interruption really important? Do I need to pay attention to this task right away, or can it wait? How much time will it take? How can I stay focused on important tasks and not distract myself or be distracted? You can easily focus on things that drain your time that could be spent coaching employees, such as the following. Attending long meetings you don't really need to, but you just said yes anyway, without thinking. Responding to every email that comes into your inbox right away. Spending your time doing busy work on tasks that don't add value. Reformatting documents, getting lost on LinkedIn, watching endless YouTube videos, mindlessly scrolling through TikTok. Reading and responding to group emails about a project or policy that doesn't affect you. Drafting an overly detailed email telling you what you already discussed with someone. Allowing employees who just want to complain or gossip to interrupt. Delegate, ignore, shrink. DIS. You may feel like you don't have options. Race to keep up the constant demands on your time and ignore employees, or spend time coaching and mentoring employees and let the work pile up. The good news. You can use strategies to stay on top of important issues and spend time coaching and mentoring employees. Remember, to stay focused on important tasks like coaching and mentoring, you can strategize and discover how to manage all the other demands on your time, so you have the time to spare. I, Leo, have developed a handy tool to help managers called DIS, Delegate, Ignore, Shrink. Here it is in a nutshell. Delegate what you can. It not only moves tasks off your plate, but it builds your team. Chapter 13 discusses how you can delegate. Ignore the unimportant. Not everything demands your full attention, either immediately or in many cases at all. Your days as a manager are filled with distractions that pull your attention and keep you from getting important things done. Shrink to what works. You can complete most things in a shorter amount of time. Work more in a triage mode, assessing what's important to do and then working in smaller blocks of time to get the most important elements done. Refer to the section, Breaking It Down in 4 Blocks, later in this chapter. Example. One Friday afternoon, when I arrived for an hour coaching session, my client, Amy, came out of her office looking sheepish. Just 20 minutes before, she had learned that the corporate office told her a major report needed to be done by the end of the day. So much for trying to prioritize and ensure she had the time to develop herself as a manager. Amy asked me if I could reschedule, and instead I asked her if there was another solution she could try to do the work and keep her coaching appointment. She paused and thought about it. "Give me 30 minutes, and we can at least meet for 30 minutes." She delegated much of the task to someone else, ignored the urgency of the client to get it all done today, and shrunk the deliverable to a first draft the corporate office could use right away. In reality, it only took her 15 minutes to write that first draft, giving her 45 minutes to focus on our coaching session and her mountain. Amy told the senior manager the full report could be delivered by Tuesday, after reviewing her calendar and other commitments. She had employed DIS. Today, Amy owns her own firm with two other principals and has learned the value of boundaries and not simply saying yes to everything and everyone. To find out more about DIS and other time management strategies, check out my leadership manual, From the Ground Up, Stories and Lessons from Architects and Engineers Who Learned to Be Leaders. leomacleod.com/from-the-ground-up/. Remember, keep in mind that although some matters may not be urgent, they may be important. Coaching recognizes this fact and the need to sometimes make time for the important matters. Scheduling in blocks and sticking to your calendar. The single most important thing you can do to improve your time management is create a schedule and live by it. When your time isn't scheduled, it's open to any interruption. When your time is scheduled on a calendar, it's filled with appointments and time blocks for you to focus on important tasks. You can plan your day, protect against people wanting to hijack it for their own purposes, and ensure you're making time for staff. Here I delve into dividing your calendar into manageable pieces. Breaking it down in four blocks. Your calendar should reflect how you spend your time down to the minute. To be the most efficient, use time blocking to group like-minded or similar tasks together. Working in blocks allows your mind to stay focused on similar activities, so you can make the connections, follow the threads, catch the details, and find what some call the flow of work. When you choose to work in blocks of time, you gather tasks that are connected, so your attention and mindset are concentrated in one mode. Here are four types of time that can help you be more productive, meet commitments, and conserve energy. Focus. During this type of time, you need to be fully engaged and focused on content and details. You're engaged in the things that make you money or get essential tasks done, like applying your critical skills to a problem for a client, facilitating a staff meeting, or coaching an employee. Buffer. This is all that time that impinges on focus time, which often doesn't get accounted for. Preparing for a meeting, traveling, checking email, and fielding questions from staff. When calendars are packed end-to-end with focus time, like meetings, there isn't any buffer time for the things that naturally happen. Factor in buffer time to maintain quality focus time. Reflection. This is time to step back and see how you're doing, where you're going, and what you need to work on. You're reviewing your vision, planning the next quarter's goals, envisioning steps for the next week, considering the strengths and challenges of your team, and considering how best to support them. Example. The most successful business leaders regularly schedule important but not urgent time. Starbucks founder Howard Schultz and media mogul Oprah Winfrey follow the practice to reflect daily on what's going right and what they want to achieve. George Schultz, who at one time held the positions of Secretary of State, Secretary of the Treasury, Director of Management and Budget, and Secretary of Labor, in addition to serving as an executive at engineering giant Bechtel Group, understood the value of time. He also understood he had to deliberately set aside time to get out from under the grind of work in order to expand his vision from what was right before him to what might be possible. Schultz regularly chose an hour in his day when the only people who could disturb him was his wife and the president. He found a quiet space and closed the door. The only thing he had was a notepad, pen, and his imagination. Free. This is downtime to recharge. Free time is just that, time for you not to do work and to give yourself a mental break and tune in to what you need. A walk, a nap, lunch, playing cards with your partner, catching up with an old friend, playing soccer with your kid in the backyard.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.